clothing, justice, peace have still not been won today for many people in the United States or in Britain, and certainly not if we look on a global scale. The meeting is part of a speaking tour, and thanks to the All African People's Revolutionary Party, Guinea-Conakry, and the Pan-Afrikan Society Community Forum UK for putting on this tour and including us as part of it. And also thanks to the NUS Black Students Campaign, who I understand have funded the transport for the UK part of the tour. We're being hosted today by the Sociology Department, put on kind of refreshments outside, so thanks to the department for hosting it. And I just want to say a little bit before I kind of hand over to Bob, a little bit about why a Sociology Department is organising a meeting like this. Well, here at Trent, we have an orientation to sociology that is about public sociology. It's about a commitment to contribute to the struggle for social justice. Serving the community is directly embedded in the curriculum for our students here, and it's also a driving force of the research of a lot of staff in the department. We also have a commitment to critical inquiry, to not just taking society at face value, but to try and delve down to the roots of oppression that people face. And a principle of dialogue, recognising the value of knowledge that's produced outside the university, as well as work that's done inside the university. So what do we feel that the university has to learn from the Black Panther Party in particular, and from other organisations with similar kind of aims? Frequently, I would argue, within the university, the horizons of our inquiry are very, very narrow. They're limited to what we think is possible, what appears possible within the current organisation of society, and without fundamentally challenging the people who are in power within that society. The Black Panther Party and other similar organisations did not have that kind of limitation. They were able to follow their analysis of the conditions facing black people in the United States to the conclusion that in order for black people to achieve liberation, fundamental change was needed in the structure of society. And not only within the United States, but also in the relationships between the United States and other countries. And they also understood that that necessary transformation, that revolutionary change, was a long-term struggle. And that in the meantime, people needed means to survive the kind of violence they were being subjected to under the present system. And that led to the development of a combination of survival programs and revolutionary struggle. Although that is a very complex history, it's very varied what the Black Panther Party meant over time and between different places. I think that's something that the Bob can speak about a bit today. So in the spirit of learning from that tradition, from other revolutionary traditions and movements that Bob took part of, now let's hand over to Bob Brown.
We want to thank you for inviting us here to spend a little bit of time with you. We suggest that this is an act of humanity, an act of culture, an act of kindness. We will disagree. We will try not to be too disagreeable, but we will never, never, never betray the confidence, betray our people for this invitation to come here. I joined the movement at 15, 53 years ago. And nobody could stop me from joining the movement. I had observed it from at least 1955 with the murder of Emmett Till in Boney, Mississippi. I was 7 years old. But my political consciousness had been aroused. And I watched it on the TV as much as I could. It was just coming online, at least My family was just being able to afford to put a TV in the house. The African newspaper, The Defender, the Ebenezer Jet magazine, I mean, I work shoveling snow, you know, cutting grass to be able to buy books, to buy newspapers that my family with 13 kids, my mother and father couldn't really afford. And as best I could, I followed the struggle. You know, Sammy Rayner took the funeral parlors from Rayner's funeral parlor, and Emmett Till's mother, Mabel Till, and he came back to Chicago with the Whitman Alliance, with the Communist Party of Illinois, Indiana, Iowa, old man named Ishmael Floyd. They put tens of thousands of people in the streets in 1955 to protest this racist terror. I heard one of the leadership of the Black Lives Matter movement, several groups, the Puerto Rican community, the consulate of Venezuela in Chicago, did a program, and different community people came and spoke. And one of the sisters in Representative Black Lives Matter made the connection from Emmett Till, killed in Mississippi, to the people who are being killed by the police on the streets of the city of Chicago. Well, one part of the history is that 14 years later, Sammy Rayner buried Fred Hampton. And I don't think that many of the people inside of the Panther Party or many of the people who write the history of the Panther Party know this simple fact, nor do they talk about it. The role that funeral parlors play in the movement. The progressive ones, I mean, Sammy Rayner is the one who signed the lease for the Black Panther Party office. I know because I asked him to. Sammy Rayner paid the rent, and he paid the light bills, and he was giving money to SNCC, to the Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and others. Sammy was one of our key supporters. In turn, supported him when he ran for city council, when he ran for Congress. When we would come into town, we would have wanted to help put the leaflets in the streets and the buttons and the sound trucks, because we kind of thought we owed it to him. He had a social mission. He understood that his job in life was not just to bury the youth, that his job was also to work with them. Sammy Rayner was working with the youth gangs in the city of Chicago before Fred Hampton, before Bob Brown. And many of them, I mean, he was one of the ones who buried them. And he was committed to the student wing, to the nationalist wing of the movement. A.R. Lee's funeral parlor, who tonight has the contract to bury most of those kids who were shot in the streets of Chicago, who don't have the money for their own funerals. He buries the people in the jails, who are in the prisons, who don't have the money to be buried. And I meet the one of the biggest finances and fundraisers and treasurers for Martin Luther King and for the so-called Chicago Freedom Movement in 65. These are little details that we don't really know about and whatnot. One of my main criticisms in the movement to Chicago today is that their sons and the people who own, who have taken their place, are not doing what their fathers did. And not giving back. Imagine $10,000 to $15,000 a funeral, and if you have 100 kids killed in the city of Chicago, imagine the political economy of funerals in the city of Chicago. And it just don't make sense. It just don't make sense that they are not. Maybe they are, and I'm not aware of it. Maybe. I kind of think it was a big bunch of money. I hear about it. At least on the night crime. So when we go back, we're gonna do some creative work. We're gonna put some picket lines up on the funeral parlors and tell them that you gotta get some of this money back. You gotta help finance breakfast programs. You gotta help do something. You ain't gonna be revolutionary in the streets, shut down highways and whatnot. But you at least gotta put a pool of money together to get these kids out of jail. Who are going to jail once again in the city of Chicago. I start that way, I'm calling it. We don't mince no words. We are here at the sociology department. Sociology would have been my academic profession. You know, when I had a chance to go to college, I refused. I had scholarships here at Chicago, 4 years guaranteed. So I'm going to go to hell. I'm going to the moon. They told me that I had to move into the dormitory because you can't get a chance to study. They were correct. I have 10 younger brothers and sisters and an older sister and a brother, and I used to go hide in the bathroom just for silence, you know, just to get away from the crowd, to try to practice German. And I was in a German class all night. And when I would go home and I'm practicing my German, my father would say, "What's better with you, boy? You sick?" And I was trying to learn German. "Could you find something better to do?" I wanted to go to fight in the war, and he was too young. So he was upset the rest of his life because he didn't let him go fight Germans. So he didn't quite appreciate it. I wish I had stayed in the class. I'm on my way back to Germany 50 years later again, but that's another old story. I learned early in sociology that one can see it two different ways. You can use sociology to adapt the oppressed to the system, or you can use sociology to give them oppressed power and tools and weapons by which they can further their liberation. When August Comte, I'm told, and maybe I'm wrong, created sociology in the 1840s, 50s, it was in reaction to it. It was an attempt by the class of forces who ruled at that time to refute Karl Marx and whatnot. So it's kind of come up with this schizophrenic personality within the discipline, within its history, its knowledge, its skills, and whatnot. It is that schizophrenia or that tendency to move too far to the right, too far to the establishment, is being balanced with radical sociologists and radical forces who are coming into the discipline, many of them who are former students. You go across the United States, you will see many former SDS people who were in the trenches, in the forefront, who are now chairman of departments, emeritus, retired, semi-retired, and you can see how they've shifted. They shifted the study of sociology in many kind of radical kinds of way, including the emergence of the new sociology movement, which focuses for the most part on social stratification, social conflict, and social change. That's the part of sociology I wanted to study. But unfortunately, in some ways, I think one of the mistakes I made in my life, I did not continue. I got the bachelor's degree, I hooked and crooked, you know, and we fought it. We put the president in, and we changed it. And as a consequence of it, I never sat in the classroom, because I'm the kind who always know more than the teacher now. And if I didn't know it tomorrow, then I'd go rush to the library. I was a smart ass in the room. And I kept B's and A's because I also worked in absenteeism in the city of Chicago because I had to stay home and help babysit with my younger brothers and sisters who always view it as a traumatic experience. You know, they always go to reunions and they talk about the trauma of being babysitted by Bob. I'm a boogeyman, we scare kids with, okay? And that's all I'm sitting on the Uncle Bob's. And then I talk about how when you come in from the demonstrations at 2 o'clock in the morning tired, and I go to bed at night, and I wake up and somebody just beat me. And they come and throw the kids in the bed with me, and I point at you. You know, quarters in the 50s. So we had fun. This is part of sociology at work. Because sociology, my understanding is to teach the forces in society and teach you how to, and the trends, and teach you how to cope with that but again, teach you how to change that. And I was more in favor of the question of change. I just cannot adapt. I cannot adapt to the system as it exists today. I cannot adapt to the lies of history, to the errors of history. I just read this document and I just quickly and I just underline and then put bullshit on this side, you know, because I know some of the facts. And some of the facts are not accurate. Some of the analysis and conclusions are not accurate, at least from my perspective. Dr. Joe Street up in Northumbria, and we'll go up there, I think, what is on the 31st?
That's right.
Are we going to do a scathing history of the Black Panther Party? Joe says the history of the Black Panther Party has reached its golden age, but it is still a contested space. We come to contest that space. We made history. And one of our biggest errors is that we permitted our competitors and enemies to interpret our history for us. And we did not write and interpret our history for us. And a few of us old folks have made a pact. We are going to rewrite this history before we close our eyes. We made history, but we made the error of not keeping up with the records. Now we made records. We made police records. And we're fighting now to get access to them and whatnot so we can see what they said about us. And you can't believe it. I've scanned 250,000 Chicago Police Department records on the Panther Party and our way to the movement. And I got an estimated 750,000 more to scan. But I'm under a court order that I cannot expose the names of the informants, the stuff in the files. At least I go ask Julian Assange to move over and let me share his space in the Ecuadorian embassy. And that was one of my assignments when I came here, go see Julian, and thank him for releasing classified files. Because how can we know what we did and did not do if we don't do the research? You are students, part of your assignment in life is to do original research, to critically look at history as it's written, and even more critically, write history, you know, reinterpret history. You have access to information on Google that we didn't have, access about us that we didn't have access to. You have information that we didn't know about, and we were making decisions and trying to implement them. So when you look at what Invader did, you must also look at it from the prism of what information you have available that we did not have available. You cannot mechanically, you know, do what we did. Kwame Ture says this bourgeois notion that history repeats itself is a lie. History does not repeat itself. The errors of history repeat themselves, especially if we don't know the errors that we made. It's not enough to tell you what we did. We have to tell you how we did it. What we wanted to do and could not do because of the limitations of our time and space, our resources, our own experience and skills. It's not enough to tell you we fed, or you know, they fed. I mean, I had enough time to send young brothers and sisters. I really didn't get up 3 hours early to ride all the way to the west side and leave my mama's 10 kids. You know, I had to stay there to make sure they got out of school. And the daughter didn't need their homework, you know, that they, you know. So I really wasn't a part of that program. I go back. I found the Panther Party, but I did not participate in it. You know, had disagreements. That's not what I didn't come to recruit babies I came to recruit college students and help inspire them to go feed babies. It's a difference. You know, if you have cadre for the church, for this, for that, the other, you can apportion them in terms of your various programs, you can do that. But if you don't have cadre, if you don't have a building, if you don't have a pot and pan, if you don't have a food, you don't do it. In revolutionary organizations, they can only attempt to implement that at the point they reach critical mass called liberated zones. And it becomes very wrong if you read the literature of what somebody did after they seized power and conflate it or confuse it to be something that you can do when you are powerless. And we have those arguments in the Black Panther Party. They cannot mechanically quote Mao, quote this, quote that. You cannot do what Mao Zedong did after he made it to the cave. Because the history of the Republic of Britain was a long retreat. It is only because he won his boundless free as a long march that the victory. But had he never made it to the Yenin cave, had he never emerged from the cave and marched back to take power, we wouldn't be talking about Mao Zedong. We wouldn't even talk about Martin King if it wasn't for the high school students and the children's crusade in May of 1963 in Birmingham. We wouldn't be talking about the Prophet Muhammad, peace be unto him, you know, if he hadn't came back from the dead. He moved on Mecca, he lost, he moved, he retreated to Medina, he came back, and Islam is all. We have to deal with history and sociology within the time and the space, the political time, the historical time, the cultural space in which it occurred. And by modern standards, it might be bad, but at the time that it happened, that's the most revolutionary that could be done. We don't measure it mechanically by the heights that you think you have achieved. You measure it from the depths from which they have come. The subject, and probably near my least time, service. Service is not new. Service is not new. Service is what distinguishes us from other animals. Anybody who takes more consumes more than they give is a leech, a parasite, something else. Yes, you receive. I hope you don't try to take. There's a difference between receiving and taking. You receive as much as humanity, as much as society can give you. And certainly the worst parents want something a little bit better for their children and their grandchildren, even the worst ones. Yeah. And nobody comes in this world alone. Nobody, not even orphans. And nobody navigates the commanding heights or the treacherous depths, you know, alone. It just don't happen. You know, somebody feeds you, even if mom and daddy don't. You know, you steal it. You go to the grocery store and you steal it. That's helping you, especially if they see you doing it and don't call the police and put you in jail. They are giving service to you, whether you know it or not. Service is what distinguishes us from animals. You know, we have to give back. There is a history of service. It doesn't stop at the Panther Party. Feeding children does not start with the Panther Party. And anybody who says that is ignorant or a liar. Al Capone fed more children in the city of Chicago than the Black Panther Party did. I know because my namesake uncle was one of them. He thought he was Italian. He was trying to integrate the low level of the mob, like many Black kids in the city of Chicago. And we would sit in these high schools. I mean, these gang leadership, we grew up with them. Fred was on the west side, He didn't know Jeff Ford and the Blackstone Ranger Gang. He didn't know Pepper Lowe. He didn't know Jerry Doc Brown. He didn't know, you know. We knew him because we were Indian high schools with him. And we were talking about we want to be like Fidel. We want to be like, you know, Malcolm. And you can see, when you go around and you see 40 and 50-year-old people named. I mean, I don't know how many Che Guevara's there are. You know, Tupac Shakur. Comes from Tupac Amaru and the Peruvian struggle against Spanish colonialism. You can see, you know, we got more Queen of Santa was in the United States than they got in Ghana. Because these are heroes and sheroes that we named our kids after. I mean, I just wanted to be crazy. You know, my daughters, the first one is Maleka Anakulu Leko Ramatulawa Ocha Green Brown. Now, learn the alphabet. Because you got to learn the alphabet just to spell your name. Leko comes from Mary McCabe, child was born while father is away. You know, Ramatulai is like Mary Jane up in the Fulajala Mountains. You know, and the ambassador from Guinea gave it to her. Wawocha, Bill Means, an American Indian movement gave it. I mean, different people gave names. Well, you know, their mama said, no, you're going to shorten this one for the second one. So we said, okay, Maleka Anakulaleka, play with that one. That means angel of freedom. So you can see just the sociology of the names. You know, the different generations, how different names, you know, you got to sit in the classroom and do attendance. It shows you how literate the teacher is. You know, whether or not he or she knows the alphabet, because we got some names. We create words, you know, to give a name. Von Rick, all his names. Well, that's, her mama's Yvonne, her dad is Ricky, so you throw it together, and you create a whole new name, a whole new word called Von Rick. I don't think there's nobody, certainly not in Chicago, with that name. So again, the creativity. We can take service, if you want, all the way back to the Bible, when Jesus cut the fish and the loaves of bread in half and passed it out to the poor. That's service. That's service. We can give the model of Mother Teresa, who gave her life in the slums of New Delhi and Mumbai, you know, to help the poor people, especially the scheduled castes, especially the next, the so-called untouchables. And she raised millions of dollars, millions of dollars. And I'm told when she died, she had only three dresses. Three dresses. She gave service to the people, and she really never asked for much alone. So it seems to me that you need to do some service. Duke Pinot at one point in time called himself the Supreme Servant. You need to do some service for the people. And you need to serve more than just yourself and your immediate family and the posse around you. The true measure of your service is what you do for children and other people that you will never, ever, ever see again in life. Certainly you don't ask them for nothing in return. I've asked the Panther Party repeatedly and been rebuffed. We don't have the credibility and legitimacy, our faction, to do that. But I have asked them to please convene a reunion of the 10,000 kids you claim you fed. And the ones who passed on, get the role. You have an obligation, number one, to do it to make sure that you're not inflating the numbers. I want proof. And don't have any aid for proof. It's in the police files. In no place else. I want proof that it's 10,000, not 20,000, not 1,000. Number two, when you talk about institutionalizing this problem, you don't just talk about what you did that day. Harry Belafonte came with the 50th Union Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee and he cussed them all out. He said, I've been here a whole week all y'all do is you come and you tell me what you did 50 years ago and how good you did it. And then ask me for some money. He said, I want to know, what are you doing today? You know, I come to find out, what are you doing today? You open the United States up. Not King, not the Nation of Islam. You were in the trenches. You're the ones who bled and died. Y'all opened it up. And the first mistake you made was you took jobs. And you weren't qualified. You know, you were not trained to be a mayor. And you went to jail for using public funds to fix your Mercedes-Benz. And I didn't know, he said, hey, they're right out of it. He told me, shut up and eat your lunch. But you know Harry, right? He said, but the biggest mistake you made is you didn't repeat yourself. You opened it up, you were the students, you fought. And where are the students today? You have an obligation to try, at least, to recruit your replacement. I mean, we fought to create these teachers. They don't come in with that bad. No, you didn't create me. I created you. The Black Panther Party of the city of Chicago was responsible for the creation of 6 black college presidents. The Minister of Education, Billy Brooks, I appointed him. He had 2 black folk. When we got him off of Wilson Junior College, he had 2 black folk. He had some social issues. He probably still do today. And with the white college president walk out the room, he slapped upside the head with 2 black folk. I said, right, that's how you done. And then I'm the one called in to negotiate. Sometime I negotiate, okay, you let him go, but he ain't on the campus. And I go back to the office and he beat me with the 2 by 4. That's what's going on. Oh, you sold me out. No, fool, I kept you from going to jail. And what was the objective? We knew we got a college president, Mace Hill Bowling. And all this talk about LGBT, Mace Hill was gay. He's part of Tennessee State Black Gay Network in the city of Chicago operation. Now, we ain't necessarily want him for other reasons, but he became the first black college president in the city of Chicago, and the first thing he did is he banned me off the campus. And that's okay. We won the objective. And now you've got college presidents black all over the city of Chicago, and they don't even know where they came from. They don't even know how they got the jobs, and some of them are so corrupt. I hope they lock the first one up in July. He's so corrupt. In that university, it costs $2 million a year to educate one kid. Because they ain't recruiting, when they got old, they always pretty gap. It's almost a pretty prison. But it's a big overhead. And if you want to keep the students, tuition coming in and keep hiking it up every year to pay for this. You know, if you don't get the grants and research and the programs to subsidize this over here, you can't close it up. It's a state school. Taxpayers are paying for it. So the per unit cost of teaching the child is $2 million. And you can't do nothing with a diploma. Because the school is so discredited because of the corruption? No. We help create people. We help create jobs. Barack Obama is the best we could get in affirmative action. He got it. He ain't done nothing, don't waste anything to pay to talk about. He the first and he the last. Now we can move to discuss quality. Yeah, quality. We put you, what do you give back to the people in return? And it ain't 3,200 tanks on the Russian border. It ain't U.S. money financing Senegalese army to march into Gambia to keep them kids, of course. It just ain't that. So I'm rambling and I'm going around, but we came to speak about service. And we came to beg you to give something equal or greater value back to the given religion. We suffer. We are suffering, not just black people. You got to ride the Greyhound bus and the Mayo bus at 3 o'clock in the morning through Appalachia. And you see the human tragedy in the bus station. It's Ku Klux Klan territory, so Bob Brown ain't gonna venture out too far from the bus station. Might not. I ain't saying it's guaranteed. Might not get back. But then I ain't venturing out too far from my apartment in an all-African neighborhood in the middle of the carnage. You know, because I just might accidentally, since I've been back, I almost got caught in drive-by shooting school a few times. They ain't looking for me. They're looking for the one standing next to me. You know, saying hello or offering to carry my bags. You know, it ain't about, they ain't shooting no innocent people. They're just people who know each other. You know, family issues, old-time grudges, drug deals that went sour. And you need to look at that sociologically. You need to look at the sociology and the political economy of violence. Violence just ain't somebody shooting somebody. Violence is starving a child. Violence is sexual, child abuse. You know, all these sociological problems that y'all are supposed to be getting degrees in. You ain't just a doctor, you're a foot doctor, or a hand doctor, or a brain surgeon. And I don't see the class distinctions because they're all necessary. But at some point you specialize. Service. When you see a Panther, and we don't have time, we might be doing any question and answers, don't just ask them what they did. Ask them how. We had some discussions earlier about food programs that have been established here in, you know, Birmingham yesterday, Nottingham. The first thing I asked him is, this Sherwood Forest and where's Robin Hood? Me, Mary Allen. And he gave me a long lecture about 200 miles that way, the forest that way. And good, you know, that's what I learned about Nottingham. In high school and elementary school, English literature. So you have information, but ask them how they did. We were talking about it, we won't go into the details, about how the food program, food buying club, food program was looking for some safe space here in Nottingham to do programs for Roma kids and, you know, different kids. You know, not just black, not just white, not just Brit, you know, but two-hour spaces. You know, each group could have a two-hour space and whatnot. And some people rebuffed it. Some folks who, frankly, were members of our party and members of the other faction of our party. And I'm sitting there shaking my head, how could anybody who's worked with us be opposed to giving safe space in a building that they manage? I mean, I just can't. I'll see them later on this evening, and I'll hesitate in asking them what the hell is going on. You know, paid to run a program, and the program's supposed to give space, and there's hesitation about giving space. Take care of the kid. Ask them where they got the business for feeding children. Ask them where they got the impossible payments, where they got the food. Ask them how they recruited the kids to come into the door. You ask them what roles did they play in the medical clinics. They gave no shots in the city of Chicago. They asked if Melania would be pressing license plates now, hoping to be a doctor. You can't do some of that stuff without a degree and without a license. So ask them who did it. You might have cooked the grits, but who gave the shot? Dr. Quentin Young was the doctor with the Medical Committee for Human Rights And they did the same thing in Mississippi 5 years earlier in the Mississippi Democratic Party. Quentin Young is one of the pioneers of single-payer medical care. You know, Quentin Young was Barack Obama's doctor. Quentin Young was Martin Luther King's doctor when he came to town. Quentin Young took doctors to Mississippi, about 90 of them, if my memory is correct. Ask them who were the nurses. Associate named Linda Murray, who at that point in time was University of Chicago nursing school. And Linda had the posse. And she's a sister, you know, lesbian. And she's the one who brought the nurses. And tonight, she is the head of the Cook County Nurses Association. So ask the question, who were the allies? If you don't have the resources, you make alliance with those who can provide it for you. And hopefully you make a good alliance, an alliance that's not exploitative. You know, who buried them? The alliance we had with San Marino. It would be very wrong for us to take his money and then go get buried someplace else in another film department. He didn't ask us to. We just thought it was kind of our obligation to give back so he can give more. You know, so I mean, that's what we can do in this time and space that we are here. We didn't come to tell you what to do. We come to motivate you to do something. If you have time, you ask us how we did it, I'll tell you, don't do it that way again. It's easier way. I didn't do much with the Panther breakfast and medical program, but you don't even have time to hear how many daycare centers I have set up. Writing proposals, making new networks, okay, preachers over here got the space, you know, this over here got the construction people who can bring it up to code. This one over here got, you know, I know where the connections are, where the resources are. And even when I can't go and get them, because I ain't dancing. You know, fiddler play the tune, dance your home tune. Passing out no more leaflets unless I help write them. You got the correct line, you got the fact, you got the interpretation, you pass your own leaflet out. Been there, done that. Because I have the capacity to think and to write. And if I can't determine the menu, I'm not coming to the dinner table. And damn sure ain't gonna wash the dishes and move the garbage out. This notion of vanguard, no. No. I want a mass party. A mass party where the masses of the people make input. You know, what we're going to serve today. You know, what this, what that, what the other. Because you got to empower people. You give a woman a fish, you feed her for a day. You teach her how to fish, you feed the family. You feed the generation, you feed the society for a lifetime. Especially if you're able to institutionalize and perpetuate. Let me stop there. I don't know if I'm
right. Very good. Thank you. So we've got a bit of time now for about 15 minutes for questions to Bob, or kind of points of discussion, issues you want to raise coming out of this being said. Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, cool. So earlier you said that with regards to history, the eras of history don't repeat themselves. I'm a little bit skeptical of that for the election of Donald Trump. I think most of us can say it's good not to have a autocratic leader, but our generation doesn't really, I would say to a great extent, doesn't recognize or appreciate the struggle as much as older generations do. For example, I haven't been beaten down or brutalized in the same way that my parents did. I think there's a bit of disconnect, and that people can look at Donald Trump and say, he might have said a couple of racist things, but we should put him in anyway. I'm a little bit worried that people, it goes back to your idea of service, that we need to get more connected with communities and not know about the problems, but really accept these problems in person.
Do you want to take two or three questions and then do that?
Sure.
So, any other kind of questions? Yeah.
I'd like to question on human rights. You raised briefly, like, well, you talked about humanity, you talked about human rights, you talked about connecting black struggles to eventually also the human rights. How do you see the situation of human rights in the United States right now? And how do you connect that kind of discourse and those kind of claims to racism?
Human rights and Trump.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry,
I'm
looking
3 hours. Okay, so okay, shut up. Another kind of one question?
Okay, I think to fill some gaps. When you see pictures of during the controversy and people being dragged and put on the Black Panthers and being jailed and police behaving in a really terrible and quite abominable way, has this been brought to the legal system in any way? Have any of the police been prosecuted? And is anything being done at the moment to, you know, you see the picture, it's very clear, and you think, well, surely this person should be jailed. Is anything being done about that?
I don't think the question is, have any been prosecuted? Yeah, I mean, they'll throw a few in jail, they'll prosecute a few, but I heard none been convicted.
Right.
It's part of the game in the system. You know, by the time 10 years go through courts with appeal and whatnot, you will have forgotten. That's why the Monell, the sister who sings, you know, what's her name, say her name, that becomes very important. It's a cultural and political statement.
Yeah.
Because we don't remember their name 6 days after they were killed. And they delay it in terms of the obstructionism inside the system. So yes, but this generation of Black Lives Matter doesn't know that the Panther Party went through the same thing. The Panther Party was founded against police brutality and police, you know, arrests and search and seizure. They don't know that. They don't even know the ideological struggle. When we said black power, the left forces within the Panther Party who object to nationalism came and said power to the people. We never said that. That's one of the major ideological struggles inside of the Panther Party. Because we always knew that all people have power. I mean, some white folk had power, and a few black folk had illusion of power. They had visibility at least with power. And so the issue was not, does all people, all oppressed people need power? The issue was the role of nationalism, the role of our identity. And now we see people saying black lives, don't say black lives, say all lives. Mm-hmm. And blue lives. Mm-hmm. Listen to us, this is the same ideological struggle and the same forces who are waging the same ideological game. We ain't playing it. We just ain't playing it. Old folks. Now, the young folk don't want to talk to us because we over 30. I remember a fool came to me and said, don't trust nobody over 30. I asked him, how old are you? And he said, 29. And I asked him, can we change that and say, don't trust nobody over 28? I mean, I see people running around with one mouth saying, take the whole village to raise a child. And then they would say, pass the torch. You too old to be in the movement.
No.
You got the wrong class and the wrong color. You ain't getting shit. I don't have no torch. I don't have nothing. But my work, my knowledge, you know, I can pass that. But I ain't got no leadership. You can't inherit this movement by patriarchy, matriarchy, your significant other, archy, or gods. You gotta earn this. We can work, and no, I'm not rich. I retired from the capitalist rat race, but I retired from the movement. As long as I get my food stamps and the rent is paid, I'm happy. Because I don't get that in the casket. No, I'm not retiring from the movement. I'll work with you. You can take the lead if we're going in the same direction. But you're not leaving me no place I ain't going. And you cannot leave, if you don't know the history, you can't leave except by accident. So, no, the issue is, no, nobody's being convicted. I see, well, maybe one or two, John Birch in Chicago, you know, but most of them, even to get, there's no white, predominantly white jury in the United States that will convict no cop of nothing. Just like they didn't convict for lynching. This is modern day lynching. This is nothing new. You know, we can see it in the difference. What's new is that the surge, you know, the tsunami comes, the upsurge comes, for whatever sets of reasons, it dies down, and two generations later, we're back at it again. Because we haven't really looked at the fundamental contradiction, you know, and tried to fight against them. So that's that. Trump, we said that history does not repeat itself, only the errors of history. The errors the Democratic Party made in the South in 1964 have simply given uneven development, repeated themselves in the North. You know, they alienated a certain class of white people. And then white people have been voting Republicans since 1964 in the South. The labor unions, the left, was alienated. The working class, and the people in the South were the working, the white working class. They were the white working class who don't understand who the real enemy is. They think I'm the enemy. I ain't got no power. They don't understand who is exploiting and oppressing them, so they think immigrants. They think black folk. They think this. And the bubble group think women. You ain't going to get no white poor person who's been through no bitter divorce and can only see their kid in NASCAR games. You know, they ain't voting for Hillary. You know, because they don't understand even the distinction between the bourgeois feminist movement and the socialist revolutionary movement. They don't understand it. Yeah, so only Bill Clinton, black Bill Clinton, you know, the first black president, you know, depending on who you listen to, you know, he got the vote, but Hillary ain't getting it. And they don't understand the alienation of those ethnic groups, those ethnic working class groups in those former industrialized areas, which are nothing but slums. They ain't pulled out. The Haitian vote in Florida voted for Barack Obama, but they ain't voting for nobody in the last name Clinton because of what the Clintons and the Clinton Foundation has done and continues to do in Haiti. Kevin Phillips, a man named Kevin Phillips, wrote a book in the early 1960s called Emerging Republican Majority. It used to be one of my Bibles. You know, these are the ethnic groups. You know, this is where the Germans are, this is where the Irish is, this is where this one is, you know, and this is where the evangelical Christian, this is where that one, the unemployed, the working class, the lumpy proletariat, he laid it on out. And they don't schedule. Trump is not an aberration, you know, and Trump don't control nothing. He got access. We'll see how much power he has. Because that system and that government is on autopilot. You can play golf like Eisenhower, you can be drunk like, you know, Bush and fall off a couch and whatnot, and the system perpetuates itself. Barack Obama had no power. He had influence. He had no power. Ain't no black president. He's a black head on a white machine. It's the same white machine. We just haven't been able to ask how many kids did he kill today. Because in the African community, we were told, give a man a chance, give a boy a chance. I'm going, oh, give a boy a chance. To do what? You know what he's going to do. You know it. You know he can't do no bad, even if he want to, you know. You know. So we could not really protest. White liberals and the white left couldn't really protest too much either because they would be accused of racism. Or they come with their guilt feelings. because they gave them a chance. Well, we gave them a chance. Now we have to count the suffering under his administration, because they're going to write some BS. He gave jobs. Good. 85% of the jobs was minimum wage, not a living wage. And McDonald's would give us that. You never come on drug dealing for maybe $2,000 an hour that will fix some hamburgers. That ain't no solution to the problem. And you, even if you stop the drugs, okay, you create havoc with a couple of problems in Bolivia. You know, just you squeeze the bubble on this end and the air goes to that end. You have to see the balloon. You have to see the holistic picture. So Trump is not a matter of history. Anybody who read history, who lived it, knew that Trump was inevitable. Trump ain't got no blood on his hands yet. Little ducks. They come, Jesse said, one of my friends, Farrakhan said, well, how you gonna vote? None of them. Y'all are preachers. How can you tell me to vote for lesser of evils? But don't even say they ain't evil. The argument is which one is lesser? How can you ask me to vote for lesser of devils? For lesser of gods? Well, they got to go home and think about that. I told my company to serve in the New York church, it turned out. We must be working for somebody if you're asking me to vote for the devil. You know, that's confusion. That's Trump. Over here, give me all the deal right quick.
Human rights.
How that the movement is connected to that discourse.
Let me just do one quick answer. Yeah. We are confused about the word human rights. You have Malcolm X saying human rights versus civil rights. You have people telling Martin Luther King, don't deal with Vietnam international questions because you won't get the social service program. If you look at the history of the struggle to define human rights, it's three generations. Generation number one is civil and political rights. Number two is social, economic, and cultural rights. Number three, thanks to the Indians, the LGBT struggles, talks about collective or group rights. So we first need to have a modern, up-to-date understanding of what human rights is. And then see how you can apply it to different times, different spaces. And that's the quickest answer I can give.
Yeah. I think we've run out of time for this room because other people need to be in here. But we have got hopefully the tea and coffee is still available out there. If people want to kind of carry on the discussion in the space outside.
Yeah.
Just
one moment. This man, you European tour, and thank you, Tom, and thank you for coming.